Thank you for using your gift, Kenny, in a powerful way this morning.
Yes.
We are moving in that direction, that time of year when we will remember the Lord's death. It didn't end there. He rose again, amen?
Amen.
If you would, bow your head and pray with me as we prepare to go to God's Word. While I'm praying, pray for me and my voice and my health as I go forward, that this would be clear today. God, just heal me. It is on that cross, His stripes, by His stripes we are made whole. Amen? And so if you would pray for your pastor today, I would appreciate it. Father, we come to you in Jesus' name. As I go into your word today, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would fill me and every believer in this room, that you would take over, that the clarity of your word, that the truths of your word would not only be clear to us, not only impact us in this moment, but that we would live our lives in accordance with those truths, that we would share the truth of God's word, that we would recognize the cross, Jesus, not just every now and then, but every day. More importantly, Lord, equally important, Jesus, you rose again. You took our sins. He that knew no sin became sin for us we might have the righteousness of Christ, and then you rose again, Jesus. Thank you for taking our place. Help your servant, please, today, Lord. I need you, and just want to do well for you today. I want us to understand your word. I need you in every way, in every truth. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's children said,
amen,
amen. Amen. Rhetorical questions. Rhetorical question would be what? Okay, well, that would be kind of repetitive, I guess. Rhetorically, you kind of already know the answer when you're asking it, right? Did Jesus ask those questions? Paul's asking some here today. Before we do that, let me start with a little test by raising your hand and participating. Can I get an amen if you'll participate?
Amen.
Let's shout again. Can I get an amen if everyone will participate?
Amen.
All right, that's a little better. So you're going to raise your hand, okay? If it's okay to worship God on Monday,
yeah,
or Tuesday, or Wednesday, or Thursday, or Friday, or Saturday, or Sunday. All of you at this point are like, why didn't I just leave it up there? Praise God. Let's try it a different way. God would rather me, can I do this, Lord? Worship him, gather with the saints on Monday. That's a little different. On Tuesday, on Wednesday. How come some of you raised your hand for Tuesday and not Monday? I don't understand. Wednesday? I'm going to do Wednesday again. Wednesday? Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Shabbat, Sunday. Now, how many of you on the second go around raised it every time? I mean, does God want us to worship him?
Yes.
Yeah. Paul had called the Galatians foolish. Ouch. Say out to me. Ouch, ouch. It was as if they were bewitched. If you would, out of reverence to God, is where we broke in to Galatians chapter 3 last week with our introduction to that chapter. Please stand, verse 1 and 2. Oh, foolish Galatians, who have bewitched you, that ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you. Great timing on your special, Kenny. Praise God for his word. Please be seated. I should give God the credit for that.
Yes.
Jesus was crucified for everyone in this room. Amen?
Amen.
You believe that?
Amen.
How long have you been at this church? More than 6 months. Okay, almost everybody. So, bottom line is, have you ever heard about Jesus being crucified at this church?
Yes.
Risen at this church.
Yes.
We sing about it. We preach about it. We teach about it. It's like a billboard sign. There's a cross outside that he's not on, I might add. He's risen, amen.
Amen.
And so we preach about it, teach about it. So there's really no, I mean, you'd have to have headphones on or something to not hear that here. Amen. It's a concept. And that's what Paul was bringing to them. Verse 2, rhetorical questions, they begin. This only would I learn of you. Receive ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? What Spirit is Paul referring to there? The Holy Spirit. Obviously, they did not receive the Holy Spirit by the works of the law. Are you saved in this room today? Say it with a resounding, with a big booming amen if you're born again and saved.
Amen.
All right. We're awake. We're here. Then you did not receive the Holy Spirit by the law either. Why? Because the word is clear. Rather, by the hearing of faith.
Amen.
And faith comes by hearing, and hearing what?
Word of God.
How many of you love the Word of God? How many of you wish you loved it more? How many of you pray that you would have a hunger and thirst for God's word?
Yeah.
How many of you, when you read God's word, as your faith is growing, you see verses just kind of, it's like God, it's like it's alive. It just shoots off the page and speaks to you. Anybody? That's because it is alive. Jesus is alive. He's the word that became flesh and dwelt among us. Amen? So by the hearing of faith, you receive the Spirit. You receive the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, because of your faith in Jesus. I'm going to give you a period.
Yeah.
Period. You can't pay for the Holy Spirit, can you? You can't do certain laws in the Old Testament, and then he comes. You receive the Holy Spirit. Many of us Baptists believe, I would like to think all of us, when you were born again. You can't be born again without the Holy Spirit. We'll see that here in a minute. Now, a side note, which really isn't a side note at all, but I just want to shift over just a little bit to the expounded version of Galatians, which would be Romans, the chapter 8, verse 9. Huge verse, because this will settle a lot of doctrinal differences. And I want you to hear this. Romans 8, verse 9. Awesome chapter, by the way. Verse 1, you find out that there's therefore what? No condemnation for those who are in Christ, right? And that, so great chapter. By the way, Gary's teaching that in Sunday school, the book of Romans. I hope you'll come. Verse 9. Did you notice that plug, Gary? I snuck it in there. Verse 9. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. So listen carefully. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his.
Amen.
Let that sink in. Can you have Jesus and not the Holy Spirit, or the Holy Spirit and not Jesus? Scratch your head. Look at the verse closely. If you have not the Spirit of Christ, that person is not his. Not saved. Are you hearing? Can we say our salvation started through faith, through believing? That's a rhetorical question right there. Can we say it started through faith?
Amen.
For by grace are you saved through faith. So we can say that, right? The answer is yes. John 3:16, we know that one. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Ephesians 2:8-9, we're hammering this home. For by grace are you saved through faith. That not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And then I also have you marked down Romans 10:17. Can we say then the Spirit of Christ was involved in our rebirth? Can you go to heaven without being born again? We're getting deep today. Can you go to heaven without being born again? Born again, I've been born again. How about you? Spiritual rebirth. So can we say that the Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit, was involved in your rebirth?
Amen.
Yes? Can we say that biblically?
Yes,
yes we can. Mark 1:8, mark it down. And then John 3:3, the famous verse, the famous encounter with Nicodemus. You must be born again to see the kingdom of God, right? You must be born again. Now, I'd have you turn, I think we've got, we really don't, but turn to Titus 3:5-6. Huge verse here, deals with a lot, and I want to make a mention to a specific word, regeneration, you'll find there. Look for that word to jump off the page. Titus 3:5-6. Turn faster, or mark it down. Are you turning? Are you there yet? Titus 3:5-6. Not by what? Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saves us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior. And I want you to look back at those verses again. Look at verse 5. Look at the word regeneration. This jumped off the page at me. We're talking about being born again. Now in the Strong's, regeneration is spiritual rebirth. The state or the act that is figuratively spiritual renovation. That jumped off the page at me too. Why? Because what are we doing, Robert? We are renovating a building, right? Now, this takes time, obviously, God's time. We're just saying, strength rises as we what? Wait upon the Lord. And sometimes you're like, Lord, I feel strong enough. Can we open it, please? And he says, wait. So this takes time, right? And so this idea of regeneration is renovation, specifically messianic. That is Jesus' restoration. So here's the difference. Here's what we want to do. We want to open this up. We've asked God to put this vision on our hearts to open this up. Women soon will be in this room, sitting next to you, worshiping Jesus, who are going through spiritual renovation, right? But here's the difference. That takes time. But when Jesus sparks this new life, this rebirth, help me, Holy Spirit, when this happens, when the Holy Spirit saves a soul, there the renovation, the salvation process, it happens right then and there. Now, there's other processes that go on, like becoming more like Jesus every day. Amen?
Amen?
But when you're born again, you have the righteousness of Christ. You went from being dead in trespasses and sins to your spirit being alive, and you are brand new in Jesus.
Amen.
So, I believe that as we're trying to renovate a building and make it brand new, make it a new ministry, come into birth, if you will. I'd like to think we're about the 9th month of labor. Labor pains are kicking in, amen? I mean, it just takes one good push, one good chuck of money, Robert, and the baby, somebody say, will be born. Somebody say, amen. A future hope, boom, here she is, right? But in the spiritual sense, when women come in here, they hear you teach or share Jesus with them, or me preach, or a Sunday school teacher teach, and they hear that they have to ask Jesus to save them, and they call on Jesus, bam, they are born again right then and there. And that happens by faith. And the Holy Spirit, clearly from the Scriptures, is there involved in the process. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
We come to verse 3. Are you so foolish? Here he goes again. Paul hitting them again with that word. Are ye so foolish? Paul knows they're not fools. He is challenging the Galatians to remember who saved them. Remember, they were buying, we learned last week, they were buying the false doctrine of the Judaizers, that they had to take up portions of the law, specifically circumcision. They had to take that back up. They had to become essentially Jews before they could be saved by Jesus. And so they were buying that, but these Galatians were Gentile believers, knew nothing of this until these Judaizers showed up and said, okay, we're great, it's awesome, you love Jesus, right? You believe in Jesus. Faith is good, but you're going to have to do a few things first, or add these things before it's going to be legit. And Paul's telling the Galatians, this is foolishness to go back and take up something you were never, take up the law which you were never supposed to take up. Now I'm amazed this still exists in our culture today. And if ever there were a bunch of Gentile Christians in the world, there are a bunch in America. I'm amazed that this is still an issue today of the things that people that aren't Jews have taken on to say you have to do certain things before you are saved. Some works or some act of man. Are you so foolish, Paul says. Having begun in the Spirit, are ye now made perfect by the flesh? It's almost like this. The Holy Spirit was involved in my born-again process. I had nothing to do with it. Holy Spirit, can you see this happening? Whispering into your ear, your soul, your being, call out to Jesus and you'll be saved. Romans 10:13. You call out to Jesus And you start to learn to walk in the Spirit, and you're realizing, wow, my eyes are becoming open, and that life from my past has to go. I can't live like that anymore. You start to understand as he teaches you sin, and you start to walk in the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, and you start to change, and the old is dying, and all things are becoming new. And all of a sudden, you come to a place, and somebody whispers in your ear, and it's not the Holy Spirit, and this person whispers in your ear, hey, hey, that's all good. I love what's happening there. I love what's happening there, but
you're wearing too much makeup. Your sleeves are too short.
Where's your tie? Where's your tie? You need to go to worship on Saturday. Excuse me a minute. Holy Spirit, I got this now. Talk to me more. Are you with me? Paul saying here, are you so foolish? Having begun in the Spirit, are you now made perfect in the flesh? No. No, the flesh ain't going to get any of us anywhere. In fact, the flesh has done nothing but the partnership of our flesh with the demons of hell has brought a train wreck to many lives.
Amen.
Amen.
Jesus, thank you for Calvary. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
It's like Jesus, thank you for Calvary. Thank you for that beating you took. Thank you for being whipped. But now, Jesus, that was all well and good. But these fellows over here are telling me we got to do some extra things to add to the cross. So just you and the Holy Spirit of God, just hang on. I need to help you out with some extra works to make this official. Do we see all the foolishness of this? Do we?
Amen.
I say this again. I get how a person that grows up in the Jewish faith, being just taught and memorizing laws, especially in that culture, laws, and all of a sudden, Paul's telling you, as we saw in the previous chapter, it's time to die to the law and live to Christ. I can see how they would struggle with that, but I cannot comprehend how people in this country over the years, especially, have turned the free gift of salvation by Jesus Christ and his work, and they take that and then they add to that as if that's not good enough. You know what's not good enough? Legalism. I don't understand how folks can do that. Jesus, thank you for Calvary. And I want to just continue walking with your Spirit, because I can't do this on my own. We are saved by faith in Christ. We walk in faith. And by, yeah, it's nothing the Holy Spirit's been hit me with lately. At 2 Corinthians 5:7, even and especially in relation to a future and a hope, is that saved by faith, yes, but do you realize that when we get up every day and get ready to take that first breath and that first step for the day, do we realize that everything we do should be by faith in Jesus Christ?
Amen.
It's an exercise, trust in him with everything that's going on in your life. Are you doing that? This is some deep stuff, so I went to one of my go-to guys who's in heaven right now, Chuck Missler, on this. I thought his words were profound and spot on. Some of Chuck Missler's thoughts. The means by which you're saved, the means by which you're justified, the means by which you're sanctified are the same. It's by faith.
Amen.
So, Devin, Jane Doe comes to the program. She comes to Pat's class, and she's in Pat's class, and Pat shares the gospel, and she gets saved. Praise God. That's by faith. Do we agree?
Amen.
And then her justification, Christ took her place just as if she's never done anything wrong. That's what God sees, the blood, right? And then that's by faith. And then her process of becoming more like Jesus, still, 2 Corinthians 5:7, she's walking by faith. Is Jane Doe going to stumble and fall and sin? The answer is yes. Are you still stumbling as I am and sinning every now and then? And can we confess that sin, 1 John 1, 9, and come back to Christ and he forgives us? Amen? It's all, faith is the word, folks. Paul is driving this home. My thoughts for a moment and then back to Chuck. Not by our efforts. Oh, I got to do a little bit more to please God. No. Our good works. Not by our good works. Not by our good motivation or our motives. Not by us stepping up our discipline. Or by selectively choosing some Old Testament laws, but not others. That's another thing that just cracks me up. Maybe that's not the word. Just blows my mind. Just puzzles me. That's probably the best word. Puzzles me. So you're just going to select a few of these Old Testament laws and expect others to keep them, and you're going to keep those. But what about the rest of them?
That's right.
Back to Chuck, and then we'll get back to preaching here. The Galatian believers evidently thought keeping the old law would aid their spiritual growth. Gee, I'm saved by faith, but it would be good for me to keep the law. Be careful, is what Paul is saying. Then Chuck shifts gears and he picks out a topic. And this is relevant here today. I've been doing some study of a group called the Seventh-day Adventists, and I won't get too much into what they believe in this particular sermon, but we all know, I think we all know, that they worship on which day?
Saturday.
Okay, so Chuck gives an example. Saturday worship, Shabbat. Shabbat is under the law. If you're a Christian and you want to worship on Saturday, fine. But if you're worshiping on Saturday to be under the law, you miss the point of Christ.
Amen.
Amen. I'm thinking 7 days a week, 365 days a year, Jesus is worthy of my worship and my assembly and my hands in the air and my singing. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
You can't add to the cross by just selectively picking out a day, and I'm not getting into it today, but Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. Yes, we should be taking a day of rest. when Robert gets on one of his 14-day in a row runs of working, I'm like, no, I'm picking on you, but take a day off and rest. We all need that, right, amen?
Yeah.
We need to spend time with God. But as to keeping the law or going on a Saturday to be under the law, what about the rest of the law then? And if you break one of those laws, you have to be wrong. Shabbat won't make you super saved. Super saved. That said, we have no disrespect for worshiping on Saturday at all. Is it the cross plus Saturday worship that saves? If you do Saturday worship to put yourself under a portion of the law, knowing you'll never keep the totality of the law, Paul is calling this, in the context, it was circumcision that he was dealing with, but in the context of our society, it's foolishness to think that saves. James 2:10, and we just mentioned this, for whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all. Possibly, this is possibly, Gentile Christians pick and choose laws to uphold for outward appearance sake. Is that really then a good thing? Bill?
I've had a friend of mine that I've worked with in the past and have tried to communicate and try to have a fellowship with him, and one of the first things he jumps on me about is forgetting Saturday is that day to worship, And
I would have said I'm all for worshiping on Saturday and Sunday.
If you worship on on Saturday, though, you don't condemn others for not worshiping on that day. Because you begin to judge others according to your beliefs.
And nor should we judge anybody that wants to worship on Saturday. But here's the key.
But I can't have any fellowship with this man on account of that.
Well, that's sad. Here's the key. Here's the key. If that's a necessary act in their mind for salvation, they're putting themselves under the law, and that's not necessary for salvation. Faith alone in Jesus saves. So it could be for outward appearance that this is the case, or a perceived, I can please God more and more if I do it that way. So I'm a fan, I think I've clearly said, of a 7-day-a-week worship. I like when Faye says, where is Faye today?
The children.
Oh, she's in the nursery? Well, I'll talk about her while she's back there. I like when Faye says, I wish we could do church every day. She's sad. Is that our hearts? I mean, she is sad when it's over. Like on a Tuesday morning, she looks forward to Wednesday. Then on Wednesday, she's like, I wish we could do it on Thursday. That's a good place to be. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I was worshiping the other day, praying out loud, singing some praise songs in the church band on Scenic Highway. And I looked over, and I'm like, there's a guy next to me at the red light. They're like, it's like the Lord saying, it's okay. He may think I'm weird, but I shouldn't care, right? Just keep on talking to Jesus and worshiping. Amen?
Amen.
Nowadays, they wear those phones. I mean, I've seen guys up at the gym, and they're like talking. I'm like, who's this guy talking? He's just having a conversation. There's nothing in his hand. I'm like, he's losing it. No, he's got a phone. No, but when we can talk to Jesus that way, right? And he's listening, and he'll communicate back. So it's okay. Worship Jesus every day, everywhere, as the Holy Spirit moves you to every day. And don't forsake assembling, as we see in Hebrews 10:25. Further study on this issue of the specific day and what the Bible has to say about that. Write this down. Write down Romans chapter 14, verses 1-7. And we also, you'll learn there that you want to be careful not to become a stumbling block. You want to be careful to be sensitive to what people's beliefs are. But just be clear from this sermon and from Paul's teaching, be clear that that's not what saves you. Holding yourself under some portion of the law. Paul's questions to the Galatians continue in verse 4. Have ye suffered so many things in vain, if it be yet in vain? Acts chapter 14, mark that down. Paul suffered in this very region in the where the Galatian churches were. Paul suffered in that area. Paul was stoned, if you remember, in that chapter, and he was left for dead. But God wasn't through with him yet. So likely they shared in Christ's suffering. There was a time, and there are places in this world today, where if you mention the name Jesus Christ and following Jesus Christ, if you share the gospel, you could either be murdered or suffer bodily harm, as Paul was multiple times. That could happen. And we also share in other ways in Christ's suffering. It says, Paul said to the Philippians in chapter 1 and verse 29, I know I'm kind of in some different spots today, but mark it down. Philippians 1:29, for unto you it is given in behalf of Christ not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. So, I've said this before, but I want us to keep this in our heads here, okay? When we're born again, the Holy Spirit saves us, we call it to Jesus, we're saved, we're a new creation in Christ. When that happens, does that mean then no bad stuff is ever going to happen again?
No.
Clearly, you're saying it again. No. Does it sometimes mean even more bad stuff could happen? The Bible's clear that we will share in the sufferings of Christ. And we're to count it all
joy.
That's joy. Hard to do sometimes, but that's what we're supposed to do. Life is not always going to be downhill, golden road with roses on the side and a Ferrari. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
It's not. It's going to be difficult. It's going to be hard. Life is difficult. But you're walking with Christ now, and He'll carry you through. And let's bring it on. Faith in Jesus gets us through suffering. Faith, there it is again. Faith in Jesus gets you through any suffering that you've been through to date and that you're going to go through tomorrow or going forward.
Amen.
That means a death in the family. That means an illness. That means whatever it is, your faith in Jesus will get you through. Never forget that. If you've heard anything today, that's what's going to get you through, Christian, as it has in the past. Now, we wouldn't say this. The law got me through it. I had such a hard time last month. One of the hardest months of my life. But thank goodness that the law got me through it. Who says that? Does anybody say that? The law is perfect. The law is necessary. It shows us what sin is. It's our schoolmaster. But the law ain't going to get you through suffering. It may remind you that some of the suffering we have is stuff we put on ourselves from our sins. But you got one?
The law convicts you to death.
Huh? Say it louder, Travis.
The law convicts you to death. Yeah. That's what it's there for.
Yeah. How about that? That's good. Is that original with you?
Not really.
Still smooth. I should have threw you under the bus. It was smooth. Awesome. Yes, that's exactly right. So we're not going to say, oh, the law got me through. How'd you get through that time when you're like, the law? Come on. We're not going to say that. Jesus gets us through.
Amen.
No, my faith in Jesus got me through. How many of you said that before? Jesus got me through that. I don't know how I would have got through it without Jesus Christ. Say amen if that's ever happened to you.
Amen.
Right? Faith in Jesus Christ. When faith in Jesus gets you through, what should we do?
Praise him.
We should praise him even when we're not through the storm. Amen. Sing it, yes. Yes. And Paul, what did Paul do? Paul was bound up in jail. Him and Silas, right? I think. And they go to singing hymns, and what happens? The walls go to shaking. He was praising him and had faith in the trouble. You do the same. Faith, it's all about faith in Jesus for our salvation, for our sanctification, for our justification. It's all about faith in Jesus. Our works apart from Christ are useless. Useless. So, a man with cancer had tubes going all up in him. He was already at the point, where they had said bring in the family, but he was seemingly, listen to that word, seemingly not conscious. And I knew the man most of my life, and so I went to the bedside, kind of had to sneak to the bedside to be alone with him. I think I was on a Holy Spirit stealth mission. You ever been on one of those? Necessarily sneak, but I just didn't want anybody there but me, the Holy Spirit, and the man.
Yeah.
And I whispered in his ear to call out to Jesus multiple times, I think. And he died shortly thereafter. Took all the tubes out. He died. I have no idea if those words through the ear made their way to the heart or not. I guess I'll find out. Maybe someone else had already beaten me to it, I hope. Amen?
Amen.
So a rhetorical question to close. A rhetorical question for you as we leave. What must a man on his deathbed do to be saved?
Follow Jesus.
Wait a minute, Tom. What if he never worshiped on Saturday? What if he never was baptized? What if he was never circumcised? Could I go on and on? Call out Jesus. I'm confident we're going to see. I'm super confident. 100, is there 110%? 100% confident that we're going to see a thief that was on the cross. Meet him. Shake his hand. Hug his neck. Thank God that God used him to be the curveball that all the legalists in the world don't know what to do with. They can't hit that curveball. They need to just go on and realize that faith alone saves. One more question. How far away is your deathbed? Please stand.